Good evening, and welcome to Christ Tabernacle Apostolic Church Bible class for this evening. My name is Evangelist Tracy Williams, and I'm here with
Minister Philippa Stewart.
And we're here today to continue the introduction on springing forward. We thank God that you could come here and be with us this evening to go more in depth into this topic. And let's get into our word. Amen. So, if you continue and look at the sower and the seed, the soweth the word of God. And we're looking at Mark chapter 4 still. And the seed, which is the word of God. So when we look at the sower and the seed, we know that the Lord is talking about and looks into the four different types of soil. When we're sowing, or soweth, which is the word of God in Mark 4, he's talking about the four different types at the beginning. This is a parable that he is speaking to the people, and he's explaining to them what basically happens as the sower spreads the seed. One particular thing before we get into the different types of soil to pay special attention to is to look at the mustard seed, which is Mark 30. Okay? And he says, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what comparison shall we compare it? It is it like a grain of mustard seed, which when it is sown in the earth is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. And 32 says, and look, let's pay special attention to this, but when it is sown, talking about the mustard seed, it groweth up and becometh greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. So if you look at the mustard seed itself, which we're talking about in Mark 4, 30 to 32, if we can see how tiny the mustard seed is, how small it is, but the great job that it does when it becomes a mustard plant and what happens. The Lord says, but when it grows, it groweth up and becometh greater than all the herbs, right? Shooteth out great branches. A mustard seed plant from this little seed, these are individual seeds, right? A mustard seed plant itself can grow up to 6 feet high, greater than all the herbs. So when we look at that, and we look at what the Bible says about it, it's small, but it has a mighty job to do, right? The Bible talks about having mustard seed faith. And that faith is tiny, but it has a mighty job to do. When we get into the sower and the seed, and there's actually a term that is used in gardening, it's called biofumigation, using the mustard seed itself. So this is just blew my mind, and Minister Stewart and I were talking about this, the fact that the mustard seed itself, when it grows into a mustard plant, actually is providing, it's a disease killer for pathogens and things that might come into the roots and into the dirt and try to kill the plant that's growing. Isn't it interesting that God made it so that the mustard plant would be able to do that job? So if we have faith of the size of a mustard seed itself, that faith will kill the disease things that are trying to come into your soul, into your mind, into your spirit, just because you have that tiny amount of faith. Biofumigation, just because the mustard seed is there to cover, and the Lord gave it as an example of faith. I thought that was a beautiful metaphor to look at when we talk about mustard seed faith and springing forward.
Amen. Indeed, because looking even at how the mustard seed will, act as a biofumigation system for the plants, and just even looking at how that faith in our life, looking at it killing all the poisons that are coming to kill us, mm-hmm. and once we're standing on our faith, that is what is going to kill and destroy everything that is coming to combat us. Mm-hmm. You know, it's trying to take us down, trying to, you know, cause us to fall away from Christ. And looking at, once you have that faith, you are able to move forward in your tomorrow. You're able to hold on to what God is saying to you. And no matter what is coming your way, your faith is killing everything that the enemy is throwing at you. So, you know, that is just so, you know, marvelous, just looking at how God is intentional in the things that he does.
So when we look and we continue now, so at the beginning of 4, God talks about the four types of soil that the seed would fall on, right? And then when we get into 13, he explains the parable. He's telling them that everybody isn't going to understand what was said, right? But there's four different types of soil that's represented here, right? The hard soil, and the hard soil looks at the fact that that's where Satan tries to attack, right? That soil is hard. It's hard to penetrate. And when he attacks, right, he attacks at the things that you have gotten, the things that you have gotten from church on Sunday, the nuggets that you've learned from Bible class. When the seed is sprinkled there, that's hard soil. And then he talks about the rocky soil. And you're joyful, but not deeply rooted. So that when trouble comes on that particular soil, when the trouble comes, you're not rooted deep enough in order to withstand. And that's the rocky soil. Thorny soil, we talk about people listen, right? With their hearts, they receive it. But they delight in things that are not of God. The thorny soil in that particular soil is not what they delight in. Then we go into, he talks about the good soil, right? And he explains to them that your heart is open and you accept, mm-hmm. right? And that you hear. And there's deep listening when it comes into the good soil. The other thing, when you look at the soils too, you can even interchange your soil, right? You can have good soil for listening to the word of God, for coming to church every Sunday. But when it comes to paying your tithes, you could be stony, you could be rocky, you could be hard soil, right? You could have a good soil and follow the precepts and characteristics of God and his attributes, but when it comes to surrendering your heart and giving your heart to God, you could be the seed that falls on hard soil. So it can interchange when we know that we want to have good soil. So now if we look, does my soil germinate? Does my soil germinate? It says here it's hard, it starts with a seed. And we have some questions for you tonight. Where has your seed fallen in life? Has your seed yielded any fruit? Are we being intentional about our growth? What habits are you creating towards springing forward? And the final question, are you seeing yourself as a victim or as a victor?
Amen. Really insightful questions that we have to use to make some self-assessment, because we know that we're walking on this journey. It's not an overnight journey.
Right.
It calls us to maturity. It calls us to shed some things. And, you know, we understand that when the word is planted in our lives, it ought to show some growth. We ought to spring forward and grow because the word is working. It is coming alive in our life. And so when the word is sent out, when God sends his word to us, you know, where has it fallen? Do we allow it to fall on good soil, or is it on stony or rocky or among thorns? And we have to understand that how precious the word of God is, that we have to, you know, hold it dearly to us, that we have to cover God's word that he has given to us so that it can come alive in our life. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, if we allow the word to fall by the wayside, then it's going to be difficult for us to grow.
Right. It'll be difficult for us to grow. It'll be difficult for us to cleave to God. Mm-hmm. It'll be difficult for us to obey God. In Deuteronomy 30, 19 through 20, when the children of Israel were returning back, Moses said that God wants you to return. He wants you so that that you'll be able to cleave to him. Amen. And he wants you to obey. So when you look at how your soil germinates, It starts with a seed. There are seeds that are scattered all over. Back in those days when a farmer or when the gardener went to soil or spread seed on the ground, it wasn't as formal as they do it now with machines, but he would shake it and spread the seed everywhere, right? So when you look, it starts with a seed. Where is your seed, right? What are you doing in order to help with your own germination, your own growth? So now when we go to ministry of the soil, rain, and sun. In 1 Corinthians, we're looking at 3:6-7. And this is where Paul is talking, I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither is he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. This is so interesting because look at what Paul's saying, right? The people were having an issue, you know, Paul versus Apollos. But Paul is saying he planted. He started. He's the one that planted the seed into the people's hearts, right? He founded the foundation. That's where the planting comes. And watering has to come in. And again, this is all ministry. Watering has to come in. There has to be some rain to assist with the growing, helping with the seed that was planted, helping believers get stronger. And then here we have Jesus coming on board, right? Amen. And the fact that he's orchestrated the whole thing, but now the increase comes from him. The growth, the overall growth comes from him. The strengthening of your roots come from him. He who is greater than us, that there's nothing we can't do, again, without the soil, the rain. But when God gives the increase, we can do a lot of things. We can buy and get a loan and read our Bible and feel that, you know, if we prayed for somebody and they were healed, or if we talked to somebody and they came to the Lord, we just planted the seed. God is the one that gives the increase. And God wants us to plant the seed. That's our purpose, right? To spring forward. Because if we don't spring forward, how are we going to be able to plant, right? Any seeds. If we don't spring forward, how is the Apollos in our life going to be able to come now behind and water, right? Or as we plant, water at the same time. Because when you garden, you plant, you dig open the dirt.
You're tilling your soil.
Right? You till the soil, you plant your seed, and right after you plant your seed, the water comes because you have to first introduce your seed to water right away, right? You have to first introduce right away the seed to the water.
Amen. And it just shows that we have to be, you know, just looking back at some of the questions that we were asking, you know, are we being intentional about our growth? Right. And looking at even in planting anything, we're pruning, we're watching, we're making sure that we're covering it from the enemy. And so even in our spiritual life, looking at how we're growing in Christ, are we intentional? You know, are we spending time in prayer? Because those things are going to help us to grow. Are we seeking the face of God? Are we in devotional time with him? Are we reading the word? And so it requires some action from us in order to spring forward, because it's going to take something from us, right? In order to have the mindset that we need to grow, that we're not staying stagnant where we are, but we're choosing to be intentional about the things that we're doing. We're creating some habits that will allow us to mature and grow in Christ.
Even, you know, the fact that Paul, in a sense, hibernated, right? That's another part of what a plant does, or a seed does. It hibernates, right? And the fact that in your hibernation, like you're saying, Minister Stewart, you have to pray. In your hibernation, you have to read the Word of God to know about the fruit of the Spirit. In your hibernation, you have to gather your mustard seed faith, right? In your hibernation, you have to have the character and the attributes of God. You have to seek his face. You have to be able to put on your armor and know what your armor does from your head to your toe.
That's right.
In your hibernation, so that when you do spring forth, when you do break the dirt that is in your seed that's coming out, that you'll be able to do things because of how strongly rooted and grounded
Amen.
You are.
Amen.
And how in your hibernation, right, the mustard plant itself killed all the disease that might come to you, the doubt, the fear,
yes.
the not concentrating, the
yes.
not looking to God, the not calling on the name of Jesus, knowing that He will deliver and He
Amen.
Will bring and He will help you crack the dirt
yes.
so that you can spring forward.
Amen. Amen.
So now let's look at fruit, your good works. We have fruit to bear, right? In Matthew 7, and we're looking at verses 15 through 20, right? We have fruit to bear. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are raving wolves. Ye shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. Then the Bible goes on to say in 18, a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire.
Amen.
Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them.
Amen.
By their fruits ye shall know them. Every tree bears its own fruit. When we look at that, I think it's interesting. Every tree bears its own fruit. Every tree bears fruit, and we want to bear fruit that's edible fruit, right? That sweet fruit, right? Not corrupt fruit, but we want to bear good fruit. The other thing I thought of too is that there are different seeds in different places that seeds grow better,
mm-hmm.
different regions that seeds grow better. There are different fruit in different parts of this whole world. And isn't it like God to know what region needs fruit
mm-hmm.
and what area would survive
mm-hmm.
in that particular weather for the fruit? A coconut tree would not survive up here, but God knows that the coconut tree is the fruit that's needed in the areas that it grows, right? A tree that is here, an elm tree or whatever, wouldn't necessarily grow in other areas as strong as it would here or sustain winds and everything. Maybe if you took it someplace else, it would because of what happens here, but it knows how to sustain the cold, when a coconut tree up here wouldn't know how to sustain the cold. So the seeds that are grown in different areas, different regions, there are different strengths and weaknesses that the Lord knows that needs to happen. Just like we're studying for Christian Ed, the seven churches, the Lord addressed the seven churches because of their needs and the weaknesses
yes.
that they had and what they needed to do. But in the end, they were all coming together to live eternally, right? But the Lord was saying, in this place, right, this is what you need to do. In Pergamos, this is what you need to do. In Tyre, this is what you need to do. He was telling each of them in each region. The seeds are planted in different places
mm-hmm.
because
mm-hmm.
of what needs to happen
Amen.
And what needs to be done.
Amen. And, you know, just looking at even just that concept of where you are planted and where God wants you to grow, that there is a need. And so it is just so crucial for us to be able to grow
mm-hmm.
because there are people around us who need what we have, what God has put inside of us. Our region, wherever region that you see yourself, where God has placed you to bloom, you know, there is a need. So He is very strategic. God doesn't do things, you know, contrarily.
Right.
He's very strategic in His plans and His purpose for us. And so where God has placed us, we have to be conscious and cognizant that He has put us there for a reason, for a purpose, for a time, and for a season. So when our season has come for us to thrive and to spring forward, you know, we need to act, we need to respond, and not sit and wait because somebody is waiting for the fruit that we're about to produce.
Right. And then at the end of 7 and 20, when it says, therefore, by their fruits ye mm-hmm. shall know them. By your fruits that you produce, people will know who you stand for, what you stand for, not mm-hmm. to be a false prophet, not to be a wolf in sheep's clothing, because we also have to be mindful of the fruit that is given to us even to eat, mm-hmm. right? We have to be mindful of what selections of fruit that we eat, because it says right here in the Bible that if it's not good, if it's not right, if it's not edible, if it's not true of what the word says, it should be cut down, it should be burned. John the Baptist said the same thing in Luke 3, that the fruit should be cut down and it should be burned, because it's not the fruit that you would need. And it's interesting that it's cut down and burned, because it has no way of coming back. Isn't that something? What is not good for us, the Lord will cut it down, burn it, and make sure it has no way of returning again. We could pick something up and pick up another piece of fruit that's not right, but it's not that first fruit, because the Lord made sure that fruit that wasn't good for us, that it was cut down, it was burned. It is our choice to stay away from those fruits, stay away from those false prophecies, stay away from something that's not going to edify you, that's not going to produce in you a good fruit to be a good teacher, whatever your responsibility would be, or to show your good works through your fruit.
Amen. And, you know, just even looking at how we combat those things, just looking at the importance of having the Holy Spirit, because we know the Bible tells us the Holy Spirit will lead us and guide us into all truth. And so if there is anything in us that is contrary to God, that is going to lead us away from Him, the Holy Spirit will lift up a standard. And so in our growing and springing forward, it calls for us to have a sensitivity in our maturity, that in springing forward, we are maturing in Christ and the Word is germinating in our lives. So the Word and the Holy Spirit working within us is able now to burn out everything that is not of God.
That's right. And the final scripture also that was on the slide was John 15:1-8. But I want to pay special attention to 5, and it says, I am the vine, right? Ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. So the same bringeth forth much fruit. And again, what Paul was saying, God gives the increase. Without him, we can do nothing. So now, we've been talking about roots, and we've been talking about springing forth. This next slide, springing forward with growth. When we look at this particular slide, right, we are rooted and grounded in what? The fruit of the Spirit. We're rooted and grounded in the armor of God. We're rooted and grounded in faith. We're rooted and grounded in the Holy Spirit, right? We're rooted and grounded with things that God has taught us, even his example, if we wanted to put that into our roots. The armor of God is there. The other things that are there are obedience is there, right? Strength is there. Knowledge of who God is there. Prayer is there. Act of repentance is there. Those are all things that are in the roots that we have for springing forward. So that when we spring forward, and I love the fact that you can look at Psalms 1 and 3, right? In order to take a deeper dive into this, in order to look at what Paul was saying, right, about him planting and Apollos watering. So Psalms 1 and 3, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, like a tree that's planted. So that's where Paul and Apollos comes in. Paul planted, Apollos watered, and that tree is near the water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. And that's what God does. He brings forth our fruit in the season. And because it's God and not Paul and not Apollos, our leaf shall not wither.
Amen.
And whatsoever we doeth shall prosper. They can't guarantee that, but God can guarantee
yes,
that.
Yes,
so if we're like a tree planted strong And if you look again at the diagram with the roots, we're like a tree planted strong by the river that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. Our leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever we do shall prosper. As hard as it can be, the Lord is saying that your leaves will not wither. As much as a drought could happen, look at God. There could be a drought. We're in a pandemic,
amen,
right?
Amen.
We're in a horrible situation. We're coming through a horrible situation where there's death, where people's leaves have withered because they've been shot down or withered or haggard with the and bound down with the cares of life because of this pandemic. People have lost their job. There are so many things that are big things that you hear on the TV, and even the little things, right, that could mess you up because of what's happening, that could lower your faith, that could make you not obey God, the things that are deeply rooted, that could make you turn from the word because you don't understand. But here, David is saying, he shall be like a tree. The more rooted and grounded we are, I can't emphasize that more, but the more rooted and grounded that we are, right? When we have Paul planting, when we have Jesus showing us and even giving seed himself, right? The 12 disciples, that was seed that he cultivated. Each one of those men were seeds that he cultivated, that he watered, that he helped grow into men that now, as he left the scene after Calvary, right, after he rose, as he left the scene, they were trees that were strong, planted by the rivers of water, that brought forth good fruit, and whatever, and their leaves did not wither. They did their job, they did their assignment, and whatever they did, they prospered. A lot of people think about prospering with money. They prospered with souls. They prospered with spreading the word of God. They prospered with the Lord keeping their mind.
Yes.
It's not all about what you can get from it, but it's what your eternity is. Because the prospering that people would think, depending on the soil that you're using, the prospering is not going to help you eternally.
No. And, you know, right? It's just so important. You just, making known that we're going through a pandemic right now and looking at where did your seed, as we mentioned earlier, we talked about, it started with a seed. And did your seed fall on good ground that now we're in a pandemic, that you are able to survive a pandemic,
right,
that you're able to stand on the word of God that you first got, that you were able to water that, have that watered, and you're growing in the word of God where now you're facing a pandemic and you are able to be in peace. You know, we know those whose mind are stayed on God are kept in perfect peace. And so this pandemic was a challenge for many people because it showed us, did our seed fall into good ground where our faith allowed us, no matter what it looked like with the physical, we knew what was happening in the spiritual realm. We didn't see ourselves as victors, but we saw we didn't see ourselves as victims because we had the word germinating in our lives and we were standing on God's word, having our roots rootly grounded in good soil and having the word penetrate us and using the word to go through each day, because nobody knew how long this pandemic would last, right? And so we know there are those who weren't strong, who thought, going through this pandemic had to make some self-assessment to see, where am I in Christ? Was I rootly grounded in God where this wind, this pandemic is coming and blowing my way? Is it going to toss me to and fro?
Mm-hmm.
Is it going to cause me to depart from the faith? Is it going to cause me to steer away from the presence of God? Because
right.
Now we've put the focus now on what's happening around us, and we're putting our perspective on the worldview,
mm-hmm,
and not looking at biblical principles to guide us, not working on the knowledge of God that we have. And so we see here the importance of being rootly grounded in good soil to be able to grow, to be like trees planted by the rivers of water, that even in the midst of a pandemic, we are increasing, that we're building, that we're being raised up, that we're still growing in Christ, that we're maturing and not withering away.
You bring up a good point, Minister Stewart, because as you were talking, I was thinking about the what we're rooted and grounded in. And it's funny because when you are rooted and grounded, or you look at the Word of God, one of the things is even putting on the armor of God, right? Mm-hmm. And that furthers our, because every part of that armor furthers our root system. Mm-hmm. When we look at the attributes of God, when we look at that, the attributes that he has shown us to have, the fruit of the Spirit, the loving, the kindness, the mercy, the meekness, when we look at those particular attributes, long suffering, mm-hmm. his character, mm-hmm. he's shown us in every way what we should be doing. And again, that further extends your roots. Yes. We have to yes. remember too that roots, because we see a tree, right? Because we see a plant, that the roots extend further than what's just in the area that Amen. We see. Amen. We see plants and trees that are mulched or have the red mulch around them or what have you. But we have to remember that a plant, a tree, right, is further in roots than what we just see with the naked eye. We can have a tree in one spot and go several yards or feet away, and that's where their roots end, or how deep they go into the ground. Because when you look at a tree, when you look at springing forward and having deep roots, because this is the introduction. Springing forward, we're talking about the things that happen below before we talk about what happens above that you can see. We're looking at what happens below to get us ready. The fruit of the Spirit is another part of it. Reading God's word is another, because when you read God's word, then you go into all the things that he would want us to be in order to show and produce sweet fruit and good fruit for someone, in order to produce that we will have souls come, right? In order to do all those things. When you look at the things that God has shown us, so if we look at Proverbs, right, 3:13 through 16, when he talks about asking God for wisdom, to find wisdom, right, and to get understanding, and then you'll be happy. Some people don't look for wisdom or get understanding, and it's all in the Word of God. In order for you to find it, you have to look. And again, if you're getting wisdom and understanding, that's part of your root system. That's part of what's going to help you spring forward. If you're getting understanding of the Word of God, if you're getting even knowledge, right, the Bible talks about of the Word of God, that again is part of your root system. Because if your root system dies, then you won't be able to spring forth. If your root system dies, right, and the strength, which is that all put together, then you won't be able to produce any fruit because you're producing it on something that you don't have. If your root system dies, then you have to strengthen it. If your root system gets sick, then you have to strengthen it through the word, through what God has built up in you in order to spring forward in your growth.
Amen.
So to get understanding. So now, let's look at the next part as we spring forward. A mind to work. And this part I sort of think is so interesting because think about the people in the Bible, right, Minister Stewart, who have sprung forward for the occasion, right? Deep root systems. So we went through all that to talk about those deep root systems that we can see from the people and from the Old Testament to the New Testament that sprung forth in order to do what God had them to do. And then on the slide, we see that, you know, there's the children of Israel that are here, Daniel, David, Esther, and Ruth. So if we look at the children of Israel for a minute, right, let's look at them. So they were isolated from their homeland, religion, right, the land to work on in order for them to live, right? During the hard time, they sprang forward. One particular scripture that Pastor uses all the time is the fact of Jeremiah 29:5-6. Build ye houses and dwell in them, and plant gardens and eat the fruit of them, Take ye wives, have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons, and give your daughters to husbands, that they may bear sons and daughters, that ye may be increased there and not diminished.
Amen.
So when you look at the children of Israel, they had to spring forth so that they would increase and not diminish. They had to be strongly rooted in what God was telling them to do. Remember, God didn't visit them on a frequent occasion, right? But he told them, he brought his word, and they were to do it. So their roots had to be strong and standing.
Amen.
Their roots, the fact that they read, right? They passed it down from generation to generation of what God told them to do. Their roots had to be strong. But when they sprang forward, right? They populated so much,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Pharaoh got upset. They came back and populated so much in captivity. And these things still happened where they were springing forward, and they were springing, and the people around them knew, the enemies around them knew that their God was with them, just because of the way that they sprang forth.
And you know, it's just really so interesting. You even brought up Jeremiah 29, just looking at the children of Israel were in captivity and looking at still being able to spring forward despite the situation that they were going through. So even for us in our own lives, we can look at, we're not just springing forward when things are good or happening around us, but even in the midst of captivity, even in the midst of a pandemic, even in the midst of chaos in our life, and even in the midst of storms, God requires us to still spring forward to flourish. God was telling the children of Israel while they were in Babylon in captivity to build houses, to increase, to give into marriage, and to get their children married. So we too, going through a pandemic, we still have to spring forward. We're not going to roll over and die. We're not going to allow our roots to wither away.
That's right.
We're going to still feed it with the nutrients that it needs, because we still have purpose to do even in the midst of a pandemic. We can't fall asleep. We have to wake, Zion. We have to be awake even in the midst of a pandemic. The enemy doesn't go to sleep.
That's right.
So even in the midst of a pandemic, we still have to allow the word to germinate in our lives for us to still complete purpose and still complete, you know, the mission that God has for us.
There were people that the enemy was trying to get rid of, to destroy, right? The children of Israel. Then when we look at the pandemic, when we think that we're done, now there's a different strain that's coming back again, trying to come back and destroy where we are right now. The stronger that we get in God, the more the battle we have to sustain, right? And the more stronger we should be, like that tree that's planted by the rivers of water in Psalms 1. The more that the wind blows, our leaves will not wither, because God will sustain us, because he has planted us.
Yes.
And again, they were the ones to spring forward. Then let's look at the next one here is Daniel. Taken from his home, yet sprang forward. In various times of his life, he sprang forward, deep-rooted. Even though he was put in places in the government where he could have turned his back on his people, where he could have done things that he would just feel freely to do, right? Who would know if they, in chapter 1, when we talk about the food and then the fasting that they did, who would know if they decided to eat the king's meat and to drink and to do what they were doing? They could walk down the street and nobody would readily know. But Daniel was refusing and said, no, this is what we're going to do. And if we do this, just like planting or just like having strong roots, this is what I'm going to do. With young people, you have your friends that'll say, well, we're going to do this, when you know that that's not what you stand for. This is what I'm going to do, and God bless them. This is what I'm going to do. You did it that way, I'm doing it this way, and look, I'm just as strong as you in the end.
Amen.
Not to come to the pressure, right, that young people face now. And there's different types of pressure. I know I was young a long time ago, but there's different pressures that are facing people and the young people right now, right? From the time that they can pick up a computer, there's pressure. Mm. From the time that these kids have Facebook pages at 5 and 6 years old, there's pressure. The enemy has already started them on a path because there's so many people that see a picture. There's so many people that see your comment. There's so many people that can get in your head that you don't even see in the flesh.
Right.
Right? That will stop you and stunt you from springing forward. But yet, there's God, the deep roots that are established, the deep roots.
And, you know, it really comes back, as we mentioned earlier, talking about being intentional in our growth. Because here we see Daniel was put in a position that challenged him, that challenged his faith. And he was intentional to say, I am not going to defile myself. Despite being where he was not going to defile himself. So he was still standing on God's word, standing in faith that I am going to do this, and my God is still going to allow me to come out looking fatter than the than those who were eating the
king's meat.
That's right. And so we're seeing here, we can be put in positions or put in places that are going to challenge our faith. But where did our seed fall?
That's right.
When it first, you know, how did we learn Christ? And we have to stand on that, you know, basis.
So then the next person we have on the slide is Esther. And the scripture in Esther 4:16, go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan. And this is basically what she was telling Mordecai. And fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go unto the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish. So she's basically springing forth, right?
Yes,
and look at what she's asking them to do, the fast, which is in the roots, right? Not to drink day or night, which is in the roots. As much as we've been fasting, it should be in our roots. It shouldn't be anything like, oh, what do we do? How can we do this? Pastor has had us fasting, and appropriately so, right? So it should be strong, another thing that's strong in our roots. And here Esther said to do it, and her springing forth is, if I perish, I perish. But she is going to spring forth and do what the Lord has asked her to do. We have Ruth, right, after the death of her husband. And she had the opportunity to walk away and leave, but she pressed forward with love to Naomi, with great love to Naomi. She sprang forth, right? She knew that she wanted to be with Naomi, her mother-in-law, right? What she was taught, what she had seen, the fact that she was married to one of Naomi's sons, she sprang forth. And, you know, even from Sunday, it's not 7 days that you have to do X, Y, and Z for something to happen. Springing forth. You look one day, it's not there. You look the next day, and it is. When we're looking at the spring and the way that the trees and everything are coming up, you look one day, there's nothing in the ground.
Yes,
the next day, it has sprung forth. And that's what we, as we're deeply rooted, it's time to spring forth. We also have David fighting Goliath. That's another one. The fact that he sprung forth, he came down to do one thing, to deliver something, and he was like, well, what's going on? Goliath taunted them day after day after day. And David's like, what's going on? Again, rooted away from, right, a shepherd boy, right, killing animals with his bare hands, knowing that God is with him, deeply rooted to the point where he said, I'll take it on. Now, with planting and everything, you have all these things that you buy from the store. You got 15,000 things. They tried to give David all this armor to put on. He's a little guy. It was too big. It was too heavy. He's like, I don't need all that. Planted, watered, God, that's all you need. Not any extra devices, not a cloth here and the oil of this here and all those things that you could get on TV. planted, watered, God gave the increase. And that's what David went with.
And it, you know, just even looking at even David's life, where God kept him in the backside.
That's right.
You know, beyond everybody's eyes and, you know, everybody watching him. And so too he does for us, where he has us in a place where he is watering us and he's preparing us for this opportunity, for this need that is in the earth that we need to fulfill, right? Because we know the word tells us that the earth is groaning. And so wherever God has you, where he has been preparing you, where he has been feeding you and watering your seed, and now it is your time, you know, whatever it is, that purpose that he has for you, there's this need in the earth realm for us, and we all have to spring forward when the time comes. So we see here, even in David's life, when he was tending to his sheep, and being able to be trained at that time how to protect his flock, now comes this situation where this uncircumcised Philistine comes into the camp, defying the God, the Almighty God, the Sovereign God. And here now David is able to step in to purpose and to destroy the enemy. So we too have to realize that we can't sit on what God has given to us, where he's watering our seeds and he's allowing us to grow. We have to spring forward when the purpose comes that he has for our life.
That's right. That's right. Another one we have is Samson. His last act, he sprung forward. He was rooted. He knew what he had done and what he should not have done. He was blinded. He was, handcuffed, ridiculed. And he was ridiculed. Yeah. They made a mockery of him once they found out where his power lied. And this is interesting, too, because you can make a mistake and still spring forward. Yes. Your roots could die a little, and there could be an issue, whatever that issue is, and the Lord still allow you to spring forward, right? Samson, who would have thought that he would have asked the Lord for one more time?
Yes.
And in that one more time, he killed more than he ever had in his whole entire life.
Amen.
That one more time. So the deep roots, you don't walk away. You don't stop because you didn't fast. You only fasted 3 out of the 7 days this week. Yes. You don't stop. Yes. You come back again stronger.
Yes.
Right? Because you only prayed for 20 minutes and you wanted to pray for an hour. Yes. That doesn't mean that you stop. You dig in deep with your roots. Tomorrow you come back the next day, or at the end of the night you come back and pray longer. You don't stop because anyone can make a mistake. Amen. We're gaining and striving for righteousness. It's not that anybody is perfect, but we're continuing to learn and to look and to read and to see, and again to strengthen in those roots. And he's an example because he called on God one last time. We can call on God. He's merciful. We can call on God. He's full of loving kindness and tender mercies in order again to strengthen our roots.
Amen. And just, you know, just even with you bringing up Samson, just seeing the redemptive power of God at work. Yes. And so we know he doesn't cast us off. You know, he wishes none of us to perish. So, you know, we shouldn't sit around beating ourselves up to say we've made a mistake and we're not able to spring forward. He gives us another chance. And it is so important that, you know, as believers, that we are being repentive, because he will allow us another chance to do his work. We just need to be yielded, right? Right. He wants us to do our work, to fulfill the purpose and the promises that he has for our lives. But we have to, you know, continuing in this walk. It is not a sprint. It is not a sprint, right? And so in our journey, in springing forward, it's going to take something from us. It's going to, you know, as Romans tells us, you know, not to be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And we've been talking a lot the last month about maturing and growing up in Christ. And this is what is going to help to propel us into springing forward, that we are maturing in Christ, that we're walking after the things of God, that we have put away those childish things and childish thought, and we're putting away worldly perspective, and we're looking at biblical principles to govern our lives in order to grow and mature in Christ so that we are able to spring forward.
Right. We have to remember that God chose us, right? And as we're planted as seeds to spring forward, because he chose us, we are open now to the things of Him. Mm. We are open. It's an open door, mm. right? The fact that He wants to teach us and to show us and to grow us mm. and to strengthen us. Mm. God chose you. God is calling you.
Yes.
God
yes.
is knocking on the door. Mm. He said, if any man, if he hears him knock, right, to let him come in.
Yes.
He is looking for you, mm. right, to spring forth
yeah.
because he has called you, because he wants you to strengthen your roots. You know, think about what you do or what you need to do in order to nurture yes. your
yes.
roots,
yes.
right? To produce good and sweet fruit, because that's what we're talking about in the end. Look at the fact of, you know, the strength of your own roots. Another person I could think of is Abraham, when the Lord told him to leave where he is right now and to go someplace
yes.
that he did not know. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Again, Abraham being strong rooted, and those type of things in Abraham's life led him to, right, not even thinking twice about having to kill Isaac,
mm.
right?
Mm.
Having to take him up mm. and to think about killing him, right, as a sacrifice.
Mm.
And again, those are strong roots, knowing that the Lord will make the way. And if he doesn't, the Hebrew boys,
yes.
right? Strong roots.
Mm.
If we die in the fire, then we die. I don't know about you, Minister Stewart, but that's a heavy thing to say. And you know, you're going into a fire.
Mm.
Who knows? They could have been standing at the door.
Mm.
If it was made 7 times hotter, sweat could have been pouring down their face. And they're saying, if we die,
we die.
God is still good, right?
Yes. The knowledge of God.
Right.
Once you come into the knowledge of God, you can stand confident in your faith
right.
that of the God that we serve.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, just the things that those that are chosen have been put through, those that serve mm-hmm. God have been put through, from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Stephen being stoned because he would not turn away or turn back from his back on God,
mm-hmm.
that he professed who God was, right? The fact that he was stoned in a manner. John being on the Isle of Patmos
yeah.
at an old age.
Mm.
Nothing there,
mm.
right? No comforts there
yes.
for him. But yet he writes the book of Revelation.
Mm.
I mean, things like that. Strong roots is what we're talking about. Maturity
mm.
is what we're talking about in order to help us spring forward.
And we don't even know what God is willing to produce in us.
That's
once
right.
we spring forward, you know, because our minds can't perceive the things that God has for us. He's willing to give us that which exceeds and which is abundant above what we're able to even think in our minds.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so just realizing that we need to spring forward so God can move and manifest in the earth realm, that needs can be met.
I mean, we could go on and on all
and
night.
On and on, yes.
With the examples.
Amen.
Well,
Amen.
But I thank God for this study. I mean, it's been eye-opening, and it's also caused, and we hope it's also caused you to think
mm-hmm.
about what you can do to increase your roots
Amen.
As you're springing forward. Because the fruit that we have to bear has to do with souls, but it also has to do with our own works,
mm-hmm.
our generosity, right? Our love, our joy, our peace, our kindness towards our fellow man, our kindness towards our neighbor, our kindness towards our children. You know, the words that come out of our mouth and what we say.
Mm-hmm.
All of those things have to do with springing forward in the fruit that we're producing.
Mm-hmm.
The transition in our life from following God and walking with God, right? Putting his word into action. Those are all things that are fruit,
yes.
right?
Yes.
Soul winning
yes.
is fruit producing. But we have to realize that we want to produce fruit that people can see and that's edible for
yes.
them, not that is inedible.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no reason to stand or say you're standing for God in that manner if you're producing inedible fruit
mm-hmm.
or part of your tree is edible and another part isn't. That's not the way that it goes, right? the fact that we want to produce something that's sweet, yes, something that's good, something that's edible. And through all of this, when you look at the last diagram, spring forth growth, that's the part where Jesus makes the growth. The God of glory makes the growth. Again, if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed,
amen,
if you have your mustard seed, is that your seed that's being planted, mm-hmm, as you grow, he will provide the growth for you, mm-hmm, that will strengthen you,
yes,
that will keep,
yes,
you,
yes,
that will provide for you. Whatever you think that you stand in need of, mm, the Lord will supply,
amen,
your every need.
Amen. Amen.
So we thank you for joining us this evening.
It was a good session, yes, yes.
And we hope that your heart was blessed as our hearts,
yes,
have been blessed, even discussing springing forward. Remember to join us on Sunday as we go into Sunday school at 9:45, live at 9:45, and then right into morning service. Also, remember the services during the week. We have Bible class every Wednesday at 7 o'clock, and then the rest of the week, there's a 7 o'clock study that happens. It goes in according to what we've been doing with fasting, and that happens every weekday at 7 o'clock. The special day is Wednesday, today, tonight, for Bible class. And we thank you for being here. Now we're going to pray.
And for those of you who are not familiar with this God that we are talking about, if you don't have the Lord in your lives, if you don't understand the excitement that we have about this Jesus that we're talking about and living for, I invite you to invite him into your heart, invite him into your home, that he is able to transform you. You might think that you have fallen too far, that he can't reach you, but once you cry out to him and turn, you know, he's just looking for a willing vessel who wants to be yielded to him. So right where you are, if you feel that you don't know this God that we are talking about, that we're serving, right where you are, we will pray with you. You can pray along with us and invite God into your life to transform your life. And for those of you who are already believers and need strengthening and want to spring forward, where you've taken an assessment based on the word that came forth today and you realize that there are some things that you need to do, there are some habits that you need to cultivate, some healthy habits that you need to cultivate in order to spring forward, we will be praying over you right now. Hallelujah. Blessed Jesus. Lord God Almighty, you are the all-sufficient God. You are the self-existing God. Lord God Almighty, we bless your name even right now, God. We thank you for your goodness towards us, God. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, oh God. You are such a graceful God. You are such a merciful God. Lord God, you are so kind, God. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this day that you have made, God. Lord God, even right now, God, we present your people before you, God. Those who don't know you as Lord and Savior of their lives, God. Lord God, right now, they repent, God, of every sin, God, of everything they've committed, God, to walk away from your presence, God. We pray even now, God, because we know your word declares that you wish none to perish, God, but that all should come into repentance, Lord God. So we present them before you, God, that you touch their hearts, God, that you transform their lives, God, that, Lord God, you open them to give them a desire for you, God. Lord God, we know, God, that you can satisfy every hunger, God. You can satisfy every thirst, Lord God. So, Lord God, we present them before you, God. They acknowledge, oh Lord God, that they've fallen by the wayside. They acknowledge, Lord God, that they are a sinner, Lord God, and in need of saving. Right now, God, I ask that you save them, God, that you deliver them, Lord God Almighty, and allow them, oh Lord God, into your arms of safety. And even right now, God Almighty, I pray, oh God, for those who have been watching, God, who, Lord God, feel as if, God, they were stagnant, they've become stagnant, God, they've allowed the cares of this world to wear them down, God, where they felt hopeless and discouraged, God, where they were feeling weary, oh God Almighty. Right now, God, I ask that you send strength from the sanctuary, God. That, Lord God, you will redeem, God. You will restore, God. That, Lord God Almighty, you will build up every broken place in their life, God. That will cause them, Lord God, to germinate, God. We pray, God Almighty, that you water the seed, God, that was sent forth, O Lord God Almighty. We pray, Lord God Almighty, that you will cover them, God. Cover them by your mighty hand, God. Allow their seed to grow, God. Oh, we ask you, Lord God, that you water their seed, God, in the name of Jesus. Cause them to walk in your purpose, God. Lord God, we ask for strength, God, that they will remain focused on you, God. That, Lord God, they will not be double-minded, God. That, Lord God Almighty, they will not lose their focus, even in the midst of chaos, even in the midst of storm, even in the midst of a pandemic, God, that they will look to you, God. We ask you increase their faith in this season, God. Lord God, you said faith the size of a mustard seed is able to move mountains, Jesus. God. So Lord God, we're asking you, Lord, increase their faith, Hallelujah. God. Increase our faith in this Hallelujah. Season, God, that we will be able to stand, God, that Hallelujah. Our roots will remain grounded, God, Jesus. That God, we will not be swayed by false doctrines. We will not be swayed by false teachings. Lord God, we will not, Lord God, lose from the faith, God, because of wolf in sheep's clothing, God. Hallelujah. That, Lord God, we will not be seduced, oh God, by false teachings, God, by Jezebels who've crept into your church, God. Lord God, we ask that you keep us grounded. Jesus. We ask you keep us rooted. Jesus. Allow us to be as trees, God, planted by the rivers of water, God. Allow us to bring forth fruit in our season, God. Allow our fruit, God, to be sweet, God, to be good for eating, God. Allow our fruit, God, to be edible for the world, oh Lord God Almighty. We ask, oh God, that you Jesus. Preserve us, Lord God. Continue to sustain us, God. Continue to allow your Holy Spirit to work within us, God, that we will be producers, God, that we, Lord God Almighty, will not be stagnant, God, but we will seek to produce even in the midst of a pandemic, even in the midst of where we find ourselves, God, that we, Lord God Almighty, will stand firm. We will stand bold, oh God, as Daniel did, God, that we will Jesus. Not seek to defile ourselves, God, but we will stand rooted in you no matter what comes, no matter what it looks like with the physical eyes, God. We will stand firm in you, Lord God. We thank you for your goodness, God, and we consider, Lord God, it done in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Have a wonderful rest of the evening.
Hallelujah, Jesus.